It's always interesting doing your thing first. I love it, to be honest with you. I'm from Johannesburg. I love being here. And this morning, more than anything, I want to start by antagonizing you. I want you to allow me to antagonize you for nothing else. I want to be the fork in the side of you. Because I think that people, when we talk fluffy and nice and light, sometimes people don't heed that as much as when you point a finger and say, listen to me. I've got some things to tell you. So I want you to allow me, if for nothing else, just to antagonize a little bit. Give me that space because I want to share some thoughts with you. I'm not really here to talk about suits and sneakers, but I do want to just tell you 2 seconds that the organization that I run is actually, it's quite incredible that we have a job. It tells you about the state of where things are at. It's quite funny to me that we're even in business because we're trying to do 2 things. We're actually trying to fix a very broken education system. But when I talk about education, I'm not just about schools and universities. We're also trying to modernize learning and development in the workplace. So ironically, in my opinion, it's the place that needs it the most, but it's the most archaic sitting in that space. So that's really what I want to be talking about. I just want to set a context for the morning. I'm going to give you the best that I have, and the talk that I often like to put together is called Back to the Future. And it's my opinion that I believe that time is speeding up. Do you feel it? So I think more than time is speeding up, I think that what you have is that the frequency of innovation is increasing and the gaps between innovation are getting shorter. And what I do is I always like to start by just giving you this image. For me, this image represents about 50,000 years ago. Right, so bear with me. None of us, barring 2 or 3 of you, were alive back then. But I know 2 things about the world back then. One was that it was very local and it was very linear. Why do I say local? If you just look at people in this picture, anything that impacted them happened within the proximity of about a day's walk. Would you agree? If something happened 200 kilometers away from these people, would you know? So life back then was very localized. It was also very linear because if you compared the lives from grandparent to grandchild in this image, nothing changed. When you look at it a little bit later, 2017 beyond, everything's changed. Why? Instead of being local and linear, what we all now live in is a world that is global and exponential. Despite it being 10 a.m., if something were to happen anywhere else around the world, Bali, China, Malaysia, we would know about it seconds, 2 minutes later. In fact, you can see the rand is very dependent on an emerging market setup. Sometimes, besides political endeavors, what you have is a rand that can dip or grow on the back of something we didn't do. We definitely live in a global world. And then I just stop and compare. I'm 33 years old, and I compare my life compared to my parents, compared to my grandparents. How did we all grow up? How did the way the world work back then? You'd have to say that nothing is alike between those generations. And if I were to have a child today, which in itself would be a miracle because they normally take about 9 months to download. But go with me. Right? You have a kid today. Imagine how much more different that kid's life would be than mine compared to my parents, to my grandparents. So what's causing the increase in speed? The bottom line is a very simple thing called digitization. You need to know 2 things about digitization. One, anytime something moves from its analog state to a digital state, it stops improving at a rate we're all very familiar with called linear improvement. And it starts improving at a thing we call Moore's Law. Anybody here don't know what Moore's Law is? Or you're just too embarrassed? I'll tell you quickly. It's fine. Moore's Law is the idea that this guy called Gordon Moore, he co-founded Intel in 1958. In 1965, after 7 years, he had noted that the number of transistors on a circuit board had been doubling every 12 to 18 months. In English, this is an iPhone 7. It's around about 1,000 times faster than the original. Not 10 times faster than the original. So when something starts to improve at Moore's Law, it starts to improve exponentially. But the second thing about digitization is that there's often a case of convergence that happens. So again, if you take this phone, 30 years ago, this was multiple devices, multiple entities, right? They were all analog. They were separate. And that was a separate phone, separate calculator, encyclopedia, record player, all of these things. Think about the MacBook for a second, right? The MacBook was a physical item that didn't change much year on year. And then it digitized, and look at what it's done in, say, 10 years, 15 years. Dramatic. So 2 things about digital. It starts to operate at a very different rate, and it often brings about convergence. So there's a very interesting guy that both myself and another speaker named John Sarnay follow called Ray Kurzweil. He did a 10-year study trying to understand the rate of innovation and what's happening. And so what he realized was, although Gordon Moore observed Moore's Law in about 1965, actually, this doubling of processing power has actually been going all the way back to about the year 1900. What was more interesting is the rate and the way it went back. It turns out that innovation and progression has been very steady in its trajectory, going all the way back from about the year 2010 to the year 1900. And this shocked him for the following reasons. He thought, wouldn't you think about innovation as having much more of a stock market shape to it on the back of three things? One, wars. Two, major world wars. Wouldn't you think that a world war would kind of stunt innovation at some point? I would. Okay, so one, wars. Two, recessions. Four major recessions in that time. You would think that, again, this would cause an up and down in the shape of innovation. And then three, for example, ups and downs in the semiconductor industry. And here's what he found. Anytime you digitize a domain, a discipline, an industry, a technology, and by virtue of the digitization process, it enables people to do more. In other words, it empowers them. There is nothing you can do to stop its progress. Not wars, not recessions, nothing. So whenever someone says to me, yeah, look, I understand about the whole self-driving car thing, but you know, it's still, this is Africa, it's still a while away. I just want to give them a hug. I just want to hold them and tell them everything's going to be all right when they don't have a job and they don't understand. Does that make sense? Here's what's more interesting to me, right? This is a slide that's showed often. I want to give a different slant on it. This graph shows you the number of devices that connect to the internet and talk to each other. My argument is that time is speeding up in direct correlation to the number of devices that are connecting to the internet and speaking to each other. I believe that as more and more of the world becomes digitized, the world will speed up. And that's a fascinating thought, because although we're about 30 or 40 years in, we're only about 1 or 2% on the back of, look at the physical world around you. Most of it is yet to be digitized. Your bed is not digitized, your cutlery isn't digitized, most of your clothing isn't digitized. We could actually point to more things that aren't digitized than are. So if you're looking at the last 10 years or so going, wow, things have really moved at quite a pace, my argument is I don't think you're seeing anything yet. I think most of the disruption is still to come. So where does that leave us as human beings? Well, it turns out that this rate of improvement is not very familiar to us. We are really linear creatures who have evolved over centuries in linear environments, excepting for about the last 50 or 60 years. Suddenly, this software, which is largely linear in its nature, right, we've just been dropped into an exponentially changing world. We really are the front lines of people who are dealing with a rate of change no form of humanity has ever seen before. And it's uncomfortable, and it's causing us major disruptive stress. And there's always this classic example. You can just see the trick going forward is to understand how linear we are and how to train your brains to think exponentially, knowing that it's not a very natural thing for us as human beings. We're not very good at it. So I don't, this is not my work by any means, but I like to often just use some examples. There's a guy called Peter Diamandis, as I was mentioning, and Ray Kurzweil, and they really came up with a framework of around called the 6 D's of exponential. Anybody followed it before? Oh, goodness, virgin territory. I'm so excited. Okay, I'm going to just give you my version, because this is actually quite widely used. And so I really do stand on the shoulders of giants. I want to give you a perspective. I told you that digitization is speeding up the world. But I actually want to just delve into that further. I think it's not just digitization, but what digitization is allowing you. See, these guys have a theory which I really subscribe to, is that innovation increases in frequency on the back of the speed at which human beings can share information with each other. So in that opening slide that I showed you, if we go back 50,000 years ago, time was flat, slow, things didn't move very often. In my opinion, the reason it didn't is because information got shared between human beings at the speed of the campfire. You had to literally be within earshot to hear of a new innovation. If someone could make fire faster or quicker, you had to physically be in proximity to them to understand it. You could actually see time start to speed up in direct correlation to the speed at which human beings could share information with each other. So the printing press, the Gutenberg moment, changed the world forever, because for the first time, instead of us physically having to write out information, it could be distributed or replicated faster and farther than ever before. Changed the world. Telegraph changed the world. Telephone changed the world. All of these things changed the world and started to speed time up, because human beings could share information with each other faster. But in 2017, information has become digitized, which means it suddenly moves at the speed of the internet, and we can replicate it at speeds we've never, ever seen before. What we can just do today with copy and paste would blow people's minds from 50 years ago. So whenever you see any form of industry, domain disciplines and any form of technology start to become digitized, you know there's some form of dramatic change on the way. But the catcher, and because of time's sake, I'm not going to get into this, you just have to understand that what happens most times is when something becomes digitized, before it becomes amazing, it actually enters into a patch of what we call deceptive growth. Think about the digital camera, right? The first ever digital camera was created by a guy called Steven Sasson, who worked for Kodak. He brought it to the board in 1976 in a wheelbarrow. And they said, what can this thing do? And he said, well, it can take a black and white 0.01 megapixel shot in 23 seconds. As you can imagine, even if it exponentially doubled year on year, it didn't make much of a difference. The board said, that's very cute. Get the hell out of my office. Come talk to us when it's doing something decent. Fast forward 20 years, guys. 20 years from 76 to 96. Kodak are now worth $40 billion in value. They're making more money than God has sheep because they own every part of the value chain. Do you remember photography back then? Worked on scarcity. I don't have to know any of you. I automatically know that I could ask you to take a picture of the speaker right now. Because you all have phones, and if you have phones, you have cameras, and I never have to have met you to know that you can do that. 20 years ago, it didn't work like that. Even if you did have a very special camera, which is really what you needed film. And between these two things, you had to have it with you. And the likelihood of that, unless you were a professional photographer, was minute. Okay? So you'd have a special camera, you had to have film, 24 or 36 exposure film, which means you had to be very careful with every little shot you took. We laugh now, but that was quite a crazy time. If you were at a wedding and your drunk tani mucked as you were taking your picture and she was blurry, you paid for the shot. And then what was even more crazy is that up until 2002, Kodak held the patent for digital photography, meaning anybody that replicated a digital camera had to pay them royalties, $40 billion in value. 1996 was a critical time for Kodak because the camera broke the whole barrier number. Intricate what it did. Suddenly it was 1 megapixel, doubling to 2, doubling to 4, doubling to... Understand? You're with me? Suddenly that level of improvement was something that the analog technology could not keep up with. And so what I'm getting at is something becomes digitized, it enters into a patch of deceptive growth. This linear pip that we have doesn't take it very seriously. Boom. Disruption. Why? On the back of three things. One, typically what happened to the digital photography setup is that storage became digitized. I checked on my phone yesterday. I have 11,000 pictures on my phone, 800 videos. I've had an iPhone since 2010. I've had iCloud. So every year it just gets bigger and bigger, but so does the storage. I'm not blinking. That's just me. That's the number of pictures I have in this room. By the count of about 100 of us, exponential. Storage became demonetized. Why? Because it became almost free by the time it became digitized. That ate into Kodak's revenue. Suddenly they took it very seriously. And you know what they did? They said to the world, we want to become the best ever digital photographer makers or photo camera makers. So they sent all their best staff with the most amount of money in the wrong direction. Why? Because what happened was the camera dematerialized into the smartphone. Right? And Kodak were quite frustrated by this. They were like, how could this happen? Look at the quality of our cameras versus what that is. And we said, yes, your quality may be better, but we're willing to forsake a bit of quality to have two devices in one sitting in our pocket. And at the bottom line is what you have a thing called democratization. Can you spot anybody who doesn't have a camera there? The truth is that at the end of all digitization cycles, it brings about a democracy. That's what's happened to WhatsApp. South Africa is one of the most unequal societies in the world, if not the most unequal society. But myself and my domestic workers both speak to each other on WhatsApp. No problem. And so you've got to start to look for other industries that are, where are they in these phases? So I always like to give you simple examples. I mean, have a look there. That first CPU board is what Gordon Moore created. 20, 30 years later, instead of paying a dollar per transistor, you're paying less than a tenth of a cent. And that was so 2012. How about memory? If any of you are avid selfie takers, in 1956, you literally needed a cargo airplane to take your selfies from office to office. Cost you your life savings. What we thought was in 2005 was incredible, right? 128 megs for a fraction of the size. It could fit on your pinky for a fraction of the price. From 2005 to 2014, that indeed increased in another 1,000 times in price performance. So I'm trying to wake the world up. This is not about a futuristic talk. It's about the impact that this has on us, right? And I want to just give you some examples of what I'm talking about. This picture really just shows you Garry Kasparov getting beaten by Deep Blue in chess. The world shrieked at the time. How could this happen? How could the best chess player get beaten? And the reality is this, is that chess is a defined set of rules and laws. Would you agree? It's a language, chess. All the machine did that was incredible was learn the rules. Once it did that, you can't outprocess the machine. Even back then, this was no match. We were no match for this. You and I can't even we can't outprocess a handheld calculator. Do you understand? That basic piece of technology. Deep Blue beating Garry Kasparov was not such a big deal. It was at the time because we didn't understand the scope of the world. The truth is just it learned the rules and the laws of language. If that's the case, is accounting not a set of rules, laws, and a language? Is law not a set of rules, laws, and a language? Infinitely more complex, but it's a set of rules and laws. And once the machine understands it, you and I can't outprocess it. Deep Blue, as a matter of convergence, has moved into the space of health. Now, I find that fascinating. The same piece of software that beat Garry Kasparov later evolved and converged into the health space, where an entity like Sloan Kettering in New York uses IBM Watson to detect early-stage cancer in humans 70% better than humans. So imagine if you're a doctor, this potential piece of software that could beat other people at chess could take your job away. There's no boundaries. Do you see that? The same thing that's happening in law. IBM is now called Ross in the law space. Baker Hostetler, which is the largest law firm in the world, recently used Ross to remove half its legal department. Why? Because it can research millions of documents within minutes. Drones. I'm just giving you the super highlights package because of time. You know, we think of it as these cute little flying cameras. But I argue if you can't train your brain to see over the hill and understand the exponential effect, you'll always miss it. Right? Amazon testing and trialing as a delivery service. In the UK last year, from the point of purchase to delivery, 13 minutes. What does that do to logistics companies and courier companies who aren't looking down there? Are you with me? How about farming? Fascinating to me, this drone they built recently uses refraction light cameras, takes it up into the air, it's got a predetermined GPS route of the boundaries of the farm. So it can literally tell where the farmer's farm is, and then it starts floating around seeing, okay, that's barren land, that's fertile land. Comes down, has created a digital map of this, and can automatically connect to the tractor, which goes and plants according to what it saw. But I argue that that's still a linear improvement, and I want to show you this two-minute video because I think that farming is on the verge of becoming disrupted in its own right.
Globally, one-third of all the food that we produce does not make it to a person. Our current food system does a really good job of growing large volumes of food. What it doesn't do a very good job of is delivering high quality, nutritious product to all the people on the planet that need it. My name is Eric Ellestad, and I'm the founder and CEO of Local Roots. Our mission is to improve global health by building a better food system.
We're definitely creating a new generation of farmers. I got into Local Roots because I was really interested to see what California was doing about the drought and how we could secure our food. So Local Roots uses 97% less water than outdoor agriculture. So we have a main reservoir in the middle of the farm. These are our NFT channels, and the water will run through. The plants will absorb what they need, and then it'll get back into our sump tank, get cleaned out, and then go back into the reservoir to repeat.
In our controlled environment farms, we have custom designed lighting fixtures that allow us to tune the wavelength of light to be exactly what the plants want and need. By doing that, we can produce things at the same cost and of the same type in the same location year round.
I want you to take two or three things away there from me. One, imagine being a farmer your whole life and you're looking around at your competition. Could you tell that your next lot of competition are three electrical engineers sitting in Silicon Valley who can tune the wavelength of light, which allows you to create Spanish Evos in Stellenbosch? Right, one. And two, they can produce the same yield in that container as it would take 5 acres of farmland to produce. Why? Because in typical farmland, 3 crop turns per year, there, 22 per year. It can grow, it can be grown anywhere you need it. Everybody's got competition coming from all other spaces instead of the spaces they were looking at. 3D printing, definitely in the deceptive phase of growth. A lot of these things get hype, then they don't quite live up to it first because it goes into that deceptive phase and people go, ah, what can they do? What can it do? I argue
3D printing is sometimes known as additive manufacturing, which should give you some idea of how it works. You program a 3D printer with a design, and it builds a thing according to that design, generally by stacking layers of material on top of each other. But one problem that's come up is that it's hard to 3D print on a small scale. If you're printing something that's, say, 0.05 millimeter wide, every fraction of a millimeter counts. But 3D printers are getting more precise all the time. In 2013, a team of American researchers managed to 3D print extra-efficient batteries the size of a grain of sand.
I don't know, who's laughing now? Hey, are you getting awake? Feeling alive? Let's go. See, I want you to have a gander with me. What I'm trying to get at today is how we need to be thinking and changing our mindset. See, 3D printing is indeed in that deceptive phase, but if you could just see the convergence further down the line. Right now I've got this cool pair of Converse, right? They were probably designed in the US, manufactured somewhere in Asia, maybe China. Think about the processes that it takes to get onto my foot from that point. Designed somewhere, manufactured overseas, we bring it here. It costs us money to transport it. It also costs us money for import duties. If these were Louis Vuitton's, luxury goods tax. All the logistics for the warehousing where it has to sit, distribution. Then from distribution to retail. Then from retail, all the marketing in the world to get to me. If you could gander 5 years down the line, you walk into some type of specialized 3D printing store with your own design, or you pick one, you pay for the royalties, and you get printed on the spot. There's no such thing as a size 10, because I stand on a plate, it measures the arches in my foot, how wide my foot is, etc. Boom. Takes out all those steps. It's coming. The democracy of fashion in that regard will come. It'll take a lot of cost out. What does it cost you to send a WhatsApp message now versus 50 years ago to get a message across? Do you see what digitization did to communication? It democratized it. Self-driving cars. Shoot me in the genitals. I'm so tired of talking about it. It's coming, not maybe. I want to give you some points of view. One, there's so many angles of pressure that are coming at it. Tesla starting to release every single model of theirs. You're talking about Elon Musk. Releasing every model with autopilot automatically featured in. It's just certain elements of ours disabled. They're saying, government, we're not waiting for you. But the second you do switch legislation, these things are going. We're not going to be reactive. How about Uber? Uber simply saying, if we remove the driver out of the vehicle, that 200 Rand trip drops about a tenth to about 20 Rand. Start using 100% renewable energy, drops potentially another tenth. At this point in time, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to own a vehicle for nil. Nil. And if I don't own a vehicle, and neither do you, what happens to insurance? What happens to roads, parking lots? What happens to whole cities? What happens if the car never has to stop because there are wireless charge pads in the road? This is version one. It didn't stop for 4 days. Solar in my lifetime has dropped a total of 200-fold. Or it has improved 200-fold. Now, today, cheaper by half to build a solar farm than coal plants without subsidies. How about the ability to edit your genes? I'm sliding through. Blockchain will do to the world what the internet did, but by a factor of 10, without question. So, I didn't actually come here to give you a future talk. I came here to tell you how bad human beings are at understanding the future. And if you want to know, I call the talk Back to the Future, because if you've ever watched the movie series, there's a very interesting thing that happens in Back to the Future 2. Marty McFly has to go from the year 1985 to the year 2015 to go fix some blunder that his son has made. You all familiar? So they have to take a peg at what the future would look like. They had self-flying cars. We've missed this boat. I'm very upset. Self-tying shoelaces, we just didn't quite. The hoverboards we have are totally shit. Okay? We definitely got screwed there. But just what's funniest to me is that in that movie, the older Marty McFly does a dodgy business deal and his boss fires him via fax. Yeah, we are utterly rubbish at understanding the future. And I want to put that in your brain. So can we bank? We are linear creatures living in an exponential world. You can't argue. None of the stuff I've showed you, by the way, is what's to come. Which is why I think we should be worried. I think we should entirely not be worried, but it's here. And it always sneaks up on you. And when you ever hear someone saying to you, ah, but that's so far away, it's that linear monkey mind speaking. It's not the training of exponential to see over the hill. So I want to invite you with me for 2 seconds to come stand up on the hill and see what's to come, because sometimes I feel like this crazy old man looking at people on top of this mountain saying, please, there's something coming, but they can't see it because they love being comfortable at the bottom of the mountain. See, my argument, and it's the point, I guess it was a great way to open today. It's not a futuristic talk. What today is about is understanding that this is to come, and how we as everyday human beings, whether we are in our business capacity or private, have to deal with this rate of change. Because the fact is, you will hear this constantly, that you will either be disrupted or you will be doing the disrupting. But you can't sit in the middle anymore. And we always think it's far away, so it's always like, these other companies will sort it out. I want to tell you today that equally, I come from a marketing background, and I believe this industry, whether you like it or not, is under siege, because it itself is changing dramatically. So, my argument is become a forever educated human being or else. And I have a very different take on education, which I just want to share with you because I think it's valuable. See, when I say the word education, and this is where I really get revved up because this is my heart and soul. When we talk education, people think back to their school days, varsity. You need to get that mindset out. Get rid of it. Education to me is just simply the act or the process of researching the future. I'm going to say it again, slower. Education for me is the act or the process of researching the future. The reason you send your kids, or you were sent as a kid to go to school, was to understand what's to come and be prepared for it. When you start looking at all forms of education, whether it be in schools, universities, or even in the workplace, it is archaic. It is not preparing you for the opposite. In fact, it's preparing you for the past. And let me tell you, I call this the broken rearview mirror syndrome. All of humanity up until us could look back to understand what's to come. Looking back is the most broken thing you can do. That rear view, it mirror, it's broken. But we still have tentacles stuck in a world where you could look back. We all do it. If you're older than 10 years old, you kind of remember a slower time back then. Back then. So I argue that education is about understanding what's to come. And if you see it like that, you would literally start to take hold and you would take responsibility over your own learning journey. And I want to just debunk some myths. See, I believe that education is the only answer that us as individuals can understand what's to come. But I'm not talking about this type of education. In 2 years that I've been running Suits and Sneakers, my aim has been to disrupt education across a variety of sectors, and I believe we're getting there. Starting to use tech, but also our methodologies. And what I've learned in 2 years is that learning is two things. It is social, and it is emotional. These kinds of events are still highly valuable, if done right, because there's something about sitting in this audience together, listening, watching, feeling a certain energy, moving. It's like there's something about human beings being together in a social setting. Incredibly powerful. Maybe it's just because it impacts every one of your senses. But besides being social, learning is emotional. Have you ever thought about why your best memories stick? I mean, you didn't even remember driving to work on Monday. I assure you, you didn't remember every gear change, every robot. But you remember every abstract detail of the day you got married, what he or she looked like, the day your first child was born. You can remember this in instant detail. I'll tell you why. Because in that moment, maximum amount of emotion was infused into it. And if you start to just go back, fuck schools, right? And the way they do it, just take it away for a second. If you look at what prompts human beings to learn, and it's a fundamental right of ours. We are by nature learning machines. You have an older system that switched that off. Because when I look at this, this is not social, and this is not emotional. It is anything but. You see, it was born in a linear time. You agree with me that in the last 50 years, we've moved dramatically from a linear-facing time to an exponential. So the current system, and by the way, I'm going to get back to its good points, but just let me have a go at its bad points for 2 seconds. The problem is that it was born in a linear time. If you think about it, the formal education system was predicated on the idea of the needs of the Industrial Revolution. We created primary school as an answer to creating better factory workers. They mimic each other. Factories and schools, especially primary schools, look alike. There's a bell that tells you, like you're a little machine, it's time for you to go in. We literally hoover kids in by the conveyor belt. 7, 7, 7, 8, 8. I challenge you, let's take all 35-year-olds born on the same day. Are they all the same? hell, you and your siblings, you could be born in the same house, go to the same school, have the same parents. Are you the same? Why do we shovel the kids in the same? Because in the back time, it was easy. We just needed kids to learn how to read, write, and count. Those who could do that were infinitely better factory workers than those who couldn't. We then created high school. Why? As a way of trying to get a system that could manage the factory workers. That's why suddenly it was more about management in high school. And the innovation that took place in the world only happened within varsities. But we don't live in that time anymore. And the thinking has shifted. You see, I liken human beings to software. You are now much more like an app, which needs constant updating. So by mere virtue that we tell our kids, we throw this message in. Go to school, get a degree, get good marks, and now you're set for the rest of your life. Go get a medical degree, you'll be fine. That made sense 60 years ago. You know why? Because at 18, you could decide to be a doctor, and that information that you learned at 18 was still relevant at 50. That made sense then. It doesn't now. And the entire system needs to be rethought, because even if the formal educational system is great, it still has one major flaw. Anybody who's over 22 years old can't just stop at about 30 and say, that's it, I'm just taking a year's break, I'm not going to eat, sleep, you know, pay rent, because I need to go upgrade my app. Can you just drop what you're doing to go upgrade? So even just how it's built doesn't cater well toward what we need, let alone if what they're teaching is applicable in the real world. So I'm talking about a brand new form of education. And ironically, I use the talk around digitization to explain to you that what's about to happen to education is it is becoming democratized. Because for the first time, you can have no formal education system in place, but you can teach yourself anything. Hell, I just taught myself 2 weeks ago how not to burn rice. Phenomenal. You can get to the more serious things. And if you think about how you can use this informal educational system, the amount of information that's there, and it doesn't have to be perfect. So if any of one of you are being that knob who's like, oh, but you know, have you read a Wikipedia page? It's not perfect. I'm like, good luck with your encyclopedia. You know, there's a mentality here. For the first time, you can use informal education to hack the system. And the reason why I used the first part of the talk to show you where it's going is because I believe if you don't, if you don't start to hack the system, you're in deep shit. Not just about your own industry, which in my opinion, marketing is literally the world of sales, marketing, advertising, is shifting at such a pace that if you don't just alone hack the system to understand that, let alone how the rest of the world comes in, you're that farmer who has no clue that an electrical engineer is your next line of competition. Does that make sense? Informal education, and I believe we call our organization Suits and Sneakers, the idea that the future of education is a mel and a blend of the two. So I don't want to throw out formal education. I don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwater as such, because every good thing that we have to this day, the fact that we were sitting in this room and looking at these screens, has come about because of the formal education system. It's just eaten itself. It has overrun itself. And the argument that I have against formal is not that it should exist. It should. But it is one of the many forms of education that you can use to hack the system. The day we get off this high horse and start saying, oh, if you don't have the degree, then you're dead. The only thing that formal education system has done well is it has formalized and tracked and measured your learning. I want to show you a 2-minute video. When I was in school, I absolutely hated geography. It's ironic. I have this big tattoo on my forearm here. It really is my ode to travel. It's my way of saying you can always make more money, but you can't get back time. I turned out to be an avid traveler. I travel as much as my bank account will allow. And I watched this video a few years ago, and I thought, I just wish sometimes we just rethought how we could teach people. Because if someone taught me geography like this, I might have listened differently. Bear with me. And listen really fast. Listen loud. He's really quick.
Welcome to the great nation of Holland, where the tulips grow, the windmills turn, the breakfast is chocolatey, the people industrious, and the sea tries to drown it all. Except this country isn't Holland. It's time for the difference between Holland, the Netherlands, and a whole lot more. The correct name for this tulip-growing, windmill-building, hagelslag-eating, container-ship-moving, ocean-conquering nation is the Netherlands. But confusion is understandable. The general region has been renamed a lot over 1,000 years, including as the Dutch Republic, the United States of Belgium, and the Kingdom of Holland. But it's not just history that makes this country's name confusing, because the Netherlands is divided into 12 provinces, Groningen, Drenthe, Overijssel, Helderland, Limburg, Noord-Brabant, Zeeland, which, by the way, is the Zeeland that makes this Zeeland new, Friesland with adorable little hearts on its flags, Flevoland, Utrecht, and, here's the confusion, North Holland and Zuid-South Holland. These provinces make calling the Netherlands Holland like calling the United States Dakota. Though unlike the Dakotas, which are mostly empty, save for the occasional jackalope, the two Hollands are the most populated provinces and have some of the biggest attractions like Amsterdam and Kokenhof. Chances are, if it's Dutch and you've heard of it, it's in one of the Hollands. Even the government's travel website for the country is holland.com, officially because it sounds friendlier, but unofficially, it's probably what people are actually searching for. Confusion continues because people who live in the Hollands are called Hollanders, but all citizens of the Netherlands are called Dutch, as is their language. But in Dutch, they say, Nederlands spreken de Nederlanders in Nederland, which sounds like they'd rather we call them Netherlanders speaking Netherlandish. Meanwhile, next door in Germany, they're Deutsche sprechen Deutsch in Deutschland, which sounds like they'd rather be called Dutch. This linguistic confusion is why Americans call the Pennsylvania Dutch Dutch, even though they're Germans. To review, this country is the Netherlands, its people are Dutch, and they speak Dutch. There is no country called Holland, but there are provinces of North and South Holland. Got it?
Come on! You know what? The formal system says, you didn't get a certificate, I'm sorry, this is not valuable. I argue, you like this stuff, you do it every day, you do it multiple times a day, across any topic you want, suddenly your frame of reference widens to a point that you can't even imagine. See, I always have a laugh about this. Meet Fat Mark. This is him, he was 12. I can call him Fat Mark because I was him. If he was here, he'd eat you. So you're safe, you're safe. Fat Mark wanted to become Thin Mark, and the argument I have is about the whole thinking. As I go to companies all the time, and I'm like, your thinking's incorrect. And they're like, we're the professionals here, we've been doing this for a really long time. And I always tell them this little story. If Fat Mark came to you because you're so professional, and you taught him how to lose weight the same way you teach your people how to understand the future, it would sound something like this. Okay, so Fat Mark arrives at big said company and says, teach me how to lose weight. And they say, okay, first of all, you have to give us 3 months because we have to suck the life out of it. We have to strategize it. It has to be perfect. We can never just go. Okay? You're going to start on 1 January. So, Fat Mark eats everything he can till 1 January. He gets there on 1 Jan and off you go. 1 Jan, he gets there. He says, teach me, oh professional company, how do I become thin? And they say, well, what you're going to do is you're going to go to gym, Virgin Active specifically, for 12 hours today. Now, for the sake of the story, Fat Mark doesn't die. He would, but in today it would be a cuck story. So, he lives. Barely. He can barely speak at the end of his 12 hours, and he comes and he says to them, now what? And they say, don't worry, you don't have to train for the rest of Jan. But you've got to be back at Virgin Active on the 1st of Feb for another 12 hours. And you're going to repeat this process month in, month out until December, and then you will be thin. Will he? Okay. And the same goes for you, by the way. I did this one short course, and so now I'm set. Are you thin? Because the hour's ass here. This is how companies do it. We do it in the exact same way. We got a learning crisis. Wait. We don't care about the internet. It's not perfect. We got to go get everything formalized. We got to get inducted into courses. Everything's got to be perfect. You start on the 1st of Jan. Here's what happens. Work. Oh, shit, we've got a skill shortage. Workshop. Work. Oh, dang, look, it's March. It's time for that conference. Work. Another workshop. Work. Another conference. Now we're getting tired. It's October, November. Let's bring in a motivational speaker because that will solve everything, right? Great for Friday. Shit for Monday. Work. Oh, look, it's December. Let's drink. We are prepared for the future. Are you? It's fucking absurd if you think about it. My last naughty word for the day. Seriously, we've got to understand this. The future doesn't care how you became an expert. And when we can grasp that, the game changes. If I can get you to go all the way back with me, this is what I'm trying to get at for the morning. And I hope it's enlivened you. I hope it has entertained you because I think that's important for it to stick. But here's what I want to get across. The world is changing at such a rate that we, as linear creatures, cannot comprehend it. It takes significant training to think exponentially because it's not natural to us. If you can make peace with that, understand that digitization is causing this pressure-filled volcano to erupt. We're not prepared for it. We aren't. Technology is deflating industries instead of inflating it by price. What WhatsApp did to communication, it took out all the costs. What did it do to revenue models? It didn't put back. There is this change coming. You don't know who your competitors are, etc. My one final point that I want to leave with you is this, because I see I've got a minute left. Have you ever thought about why it is that you earn what you earn? You know, your salary. It's not just a random number. We didn't just spin a dice and be like, that's your salary. It somehow gets set according to the value of the problem that you can solve. I'm going to say it again. I think you earn, and companies, by the way, turn or make money according to the value of the problem that they can solve. For the first time in the world, you have an abundance of a system where you can hack your life and increase your value by increasing your context of the world. And I can tell you it's living proof, because company upon company are starting to use my company to fix their education systems in the workplace. They're asking a guy with no matric to fix their learning. You do the math.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.